So seaweeds like these around me here play much the same role on the seashore as flowering plants do on land. But they're a different group of organisms and they have a different structure. So flowering plants on land have to put down their roots into the soil to get the moisture, to get the water, and then they move that water up their trunks to the leaves where it transpires into the air and where photosynthesis takes place. Seaweeds are in the water all the time, so they don't need to move that water, they just absorb the water all the way across the surface of their fronds, which is the equivalent of their leaves. And they also don't need to have roots because they don't need to extract water from the soil. So they rather have a thing called a holdfast, which is like a sticky attachment, and it holds the organism fast onto the rocks. And then they absorb water and do the photosynthesis over the whole surface of the seaweed.
And they're also pretty similar in the food chain, right? They form the basis of the food chain.
They serve the exact same purpose in the food chain. So they're doing the photosynthesis and they're fed upon by the grazers in the system. And they also create structure on the seashore. They're creating habitat with all the little animals living. So little worms and crustaceans and mollusks and even little fish live amongst those seaweeds. So one of the important differences, though, is that there's no equivalent to the great Amazon rainforest in the sea. The seashore, the seaweeds on the seashore are actually a very narrow belt because they only go from the mid-intertidal to about 20 meters depth. So if you were to plot the seaweeds of the world on a map, it would just be a very, very thin line along the rocky coastline.
And that's because of the sunlight, right? When you get too deep, you don't get enough sun.
Yes, that's right. Then to photosynthesize, they need to have bright sunlight, and then the sun is absorbed by the water. So beyond about 20 or even in clear waters, beyond about 30 meters depth, then you don't get seaweeds. So you can actually kind of see the edge of the seaweeds here. They're a very thin zone. So probably like less than 0.1% of the ocean actually is habitat for seaweeds. And there's none of these enormous areas like millions of square kilometers of Amazon rainforest. Yes, my boy, you come to see the seaweeds. I'll show you the seaweeds. There you go, Ben. The seaweeds are divided into three main groups based on the pigments that they have in them. So this is a green seaweed. That's one of the main groups. And these are always nice and bright and green. They're quite easy to recognize. And then this is a red seaweed. And this particular one is quite nice and red. But unfortunately, for this classification system, quite a lot of seaweeds actually have both red and brown pigments in them. So quite a lot of the seaweeds that are taxonomically red seaweeds are actually fairly brown in color. So this one, for example, is actually a red seaweed, but it's quite brown. And then the brown seaweeds are the smallest group. And this is the best known representative of the brown seaweeds, the kelps. And we've got another episode which gives you a whole lot of detail about the kelps.
So the green, the red, the brown seaweeds, are they also different in where they grow, what eats on them, you know, they form different groups?
Taxonomically, they're very different groups in terms of their life history. In fact, green seaweeds and red seaweeds are plants. They're in the kingdom plantae, they're related to flowering plants. But actually, brown seaweeds are related to phytoplankton, their closest relatives are unicellular organisms. So they're in the kingdom Chromista. They're not even plants. Formally, they're not plants. But the reason why the seaweeds have these different colors is because they're absorbing different wavelengths of light. So the best color to be in the high intertidal or in the air is to be green. But most of the red light is actually absorbed in the top few meters of seawater. And so the red algae, which are best at absorbing blue light, they tend to occur in slightly deeper water.
So you won't find any greens after a couple of meters.
Yeah, so as you go deeper, you tend to go from predominantly green seaweeds to predominantly red seaweeds. So many explorers on the shore don't pay all that much attention to the seaweeds and just actually slip on them while they're going across the shore trying to get to some interesting animals to look at. But actually, seaweeds have some very interesting characteristics. Several of the seaweeds on this piece of shore here are very iridescent. They have the most beautiful iridescent blue and green coloration. And as you move past the seaweed, those colors change. So they're a bit like the colors on a soap bubble. So they're structural colors. They're not actually caused by pigments, but they're caused by reflection and refraction of the light as it hits the algae and then bounces off the different layers in its epidermis.
That's quite a like startling thing to see on the shore. Is there any benefit to them having that?
They're incredibly bright and nobody really knows exactly what it's for. It's not been proven. But the speculation is that it might be protection against ultraviolet light because of a lot of the light, especially the ultraviolet, is reflected. Or the other speculation is that it might be a protection from herbivores, that when a herbivore goes up to it and then it starts flashing all these bright green and blue colors, then it puts it off. And now my bum's getting wet. Some of the seaweeds high on the shore also have a remarkable ability to dry out during low tide when they're in the sun, and then to rehydrate and be perfectly happy again when the water comes in and they're wetted again. This one here is Nori. This is the stuff that sushi gets wrapped in. And at low water, it actually dries out to such a point that it's actually crispy. And then when the sea comes in again, when the tide comes in again and wets it, it very quickly resorbs the water again and then it's perfectly fine. Another interesting group of red algae are the so-called coralline algae. And they actually incorporate calcium carbonate or limestone into the plant. And the plant becomes hard and stiff. So there are two different types. They're what we call erect coralline algae, that is ones that grow up into a bush. And they have a series of segments like beads. Each segment is like a little stone. It's completely hard and it can't flex. And between each of those segments is a little flexing joint. So the plant can actually move in the current, but it's moving only at the joints, and the individual segments are just like little pieces of rock. Another group of corallines are called the encrusting corallines, and they completely flat on the rock surface. They actually look very much like spilt pink paint on the rocks, and many seashore explorers don't even recognize that they're looking at a living organism. They think it's just pink rock. But these are living organisms. They have living cells in them. They're growing all the time, expanding along their edges. And it's just that the cells within the organism are packed with limestone and are very hard. And this is an anti-herbivore device to actually make it very difficult for winkles and other grazers to actually consume the algae. So next time when you're on the seashore, pay a little bit more attention to the seaweeds. Not only are some of the seaweeds very beautiful with their iridescent colors and their amazing forms, but also you'll see many, many organisms living on those seaweeds. Some of them are actually completely specific to the surfaces of seaweeds. There are hydroids, bryozoans, various other organisms that live only on seaweeds. They're not just slippery things, they're food for many species, habitat for many species, and they're an interesting component of the seashore. And you can even take some home and eat them. So pay a bit more attention to them next time. And I'm going to get washed away here now.
Hit subscribe if you want to see more Explore the Shore.